at the time, it was really hard to get international film. The more we watched him, and I gotta give credit to RC, obviously, because he's the one that made all the decisions, and he was, I knew how much you liked him. But I think it was like the fearlessness, you know, at such a young age.
You know, in France, they always say I had the big head because they would say I was too much confidence, you know, too much, you know. When I was telling people I was 15 years old in France, I want to go in the NBA, you know, I'd be the first point guard who make an NBA. They thought I was crazy, you know, they say you're too cocky.
The first time we saw him was here in the U.S. He played in the Nike Hoop Summit, and he'd have been 17, 18 at the time.
The 2000 Nike Hoop Summit as Parker hangs in the air. All of a sudden, Tony Parker's showing us something.
He's made a couple really solid moves.
6'2 guard from Belgium, whose father played in Chicago, Illinois. They moved to France, and that's where Tony grew up. Parker, beautiful job. Oh, nice spin move.
Great spin.
Beautiful.
Because he was able to get it up high off the glass.
Tony Parker.
Of the 30 teams, if you split the teams down the middle, there were probably half the people who loved Tony as a player and half of the teams who didn't see it at all.
We had him come for a workout and RC and I were so excited. We had never seen him play in person.
First workout was in Chicago. I just flew like 10 hours, just landed, went straight to the workout. And so obviously I didn't do too well. I was still jet lagged, tired.
Lance Blanks, who had just retired from playing, was working with us, and every time he walked on the court, he was still trying to prove that he could still play. So he beat the heck out of Tony in this workout. That wasn't exactly what we were looking for.
My very, very first impression was that he was maybe not as tough as he needed to be.
Pop didn't want to see me again. He thought I was like too soft and I was not going to make it, that I didn't have it. And RC really insisted to see me a second time, because RC and Sam Presti, they're the one who saw me play in France and watched my film a lot. I'm not even sure Pop watched the film.
I knew RC was so disappointed because he really liked Tony.
Presti and I were big fans. The day of the first draft workout, it went so poorly that I was begging Tony's agent, Mark Fleischer, we need to get him back in. We'll schedule the Sunday before the draft back in San Antonio. Well, he gets injured, he misses going to a couple cities. We were the last pick in the first round. So we just assumed that we were gonna get that workout pulled from us and that Tony was gonna go someplace else and he'd be gone by the time it came to us. Somehow, Mark sent him back to us. And Tony was just spectacular, even though he was really banged up. By the end of the draft, as many places he'd worked out, physically, you're just depleted.
He convinced me in the next workout or two that I was totally wrong.
After the workout ends, Tony leaves, whatever. We all walked out and are standing in the parking lot of Incarnate Word. RC, myself, and Pop. And everyone's just kind of looking around, kind of waiting for someone to say something, because I think we all realized what we saw.
Pop walks outside and grabs me and Presti and goes,
"That guy's a starting point guard in the NBA for 10 years.
But he'll never be there."
When I finished my workout with San Antonio, before I went to New York, I called my dad and I was like, "Man, I love San Antonio. I would love to play here. I don't know, I like the vibe of the city, the atmosphere. Maybe I have no chance to be at the end of the first round, but I really hope that, you know, I can slip all the way to 28 because I want to play with a good team."
We spent the whole week trying to move up, and for whatever reason, we couldn't get up. And there were a bunch of teams that needed point guards ahead of us. I think we started at like 17 trying to get in, and it just like, there were several teams along the way that took other point guards instead of Tony for their own reasons, and somehow he made it to us.
You have Chrissy, who works for the NBA. She tells me, "Okay, you have to be ready. Boston's gonna draft you." Gives me the cap, Celtics cap. And then 1 minute after, she's like, "Come back." He came back, she's like, "No, no, no. They changed their mind." And so I didn't get drafted by Boston. So this can tell you how close it was to go to Boston. And then at 28, Pop, like he said, kept his word and drafted me.
With the 28th pick in the 2001 draft, The San Antonio Spurs select Tony Parker.
In the draft, I was excited, you know, just happy, you know, play with a good team, play with superstars. Really excited and can't wait just to meet them, play with them.
You passed the ball to a lot of players, but probably not two as good as David Robinson and Tim Duncan. Enjoy it.
I will pass the ball to Duncan Robinson, no problem.
First impressions, skinny little kid. Freaking, how old was he, like 12 when you showed up here? And having him call plays and trying to figure out what he's trying to say, I remember that part early on.
You know, back then, Americans had a little respect, you know, for European basketball, especially a little French point guard. So I had to earn that respect every day. I remember during camp, Kevin Willis did a hard foul on me. And so then I pushed him, like we got into like a little fight, and Pop loved it. But I didn't know at the time, you know, but I was just trying to earn the respect of my teammates. And even if I was 19 years old, I was not going to back down.
I remember that kid coming to my games in France. And now he's this? Didn't know any of that stuff was going on then. And so for Tony to be playing professional at 16, this was a passion of his. You know, some kids and some individuals, you just know that what they want in life. But that was the thing with Tony. Tony knew he wanted to be an NBA player, and that's what he strived to do.
Having to deal with Pop at that role, in point guard position at 19 or 18, oh my God, he took it. And he grew, and he became a man and a leader and an MVP, all-star, so remarkable story.
That might be the most remarkable thing about Tony. I mean, you can see his talent and his speed, and he finished at the rim and worked hard, but his maturity level was off the charts. He knew how to handle himself off the court. He was able to handle criticism, because I was very tough on him. And he just took it all in and got better and better, got tougher and tougher. At that young age, he was pretty remarkable.
Like father and son, you know, he's always behind me, pushed me hard, you know, and it's just the beginning. We got three or more, four championships, you know, it's just the beginning.